Our inquiry does not end with 15 or 16 million or 73 million. Sa totoo lang, 612.5 million ang kabuang halaga ng confidential fund ang ibinigay sa OVP and DepEd sa loob ng 2 taon. Dito po makikita po natin. Lahat. Welcome to the 4th public hearing of the House Committee on Good Government and Public Accountability. Before we start, we thank our guest resource persons and witnesses for understanding why we had to postpone the previously scheduled hearing on October 28. Ito ay upang matulungan bumangon muli ang ating mga kababayan na lubhang nasalanta ng Bagyong Christine. Narito tayo ngayong araw upang talakayin muli ang issue ng pondo ng bayan. Pondong mas nailagak sana sa mga kababayan nating naapektuhan ng mga nakalipas na bagyo. Earlier this year ay pumasa sa Kamara at inaprubahan ang Republic Act No. 12009 o ang New Government Procurement Act. Binabalangkas ng batas na ito ang mga pundasyon ng government procurement. Kabilang dito ang prinsipyo ng transparency, competitiveness, and participatory. Ngunit pagdating sa confidential funds, binabalanse ang prinsipyo ng transparency sa national security. Kung kaya't kapag confidential funds na ang pinag-uusapan, hindi basta-bastang nalalaman kung saan ito ginagamit at kung kanino dapat bumili. This committee, however, recognizes that confidential funds are necessary to ensure safety and national security. Ngunit dahil ang confidential funds ay natural na palihim kung gamitin, madaling maabuso ang paggamit nito, lalo na kung hindi mahigpit ang patakaran sa paggastos nito. Natural lamang na ang mga pagkakalooban ng confidential funds ay mga ahensyang mapagkakatiwala ang gagamitin ito para sa mga programang pangseguridad ng bansa. Ito ang pakay ng inquiry ng komiting ito. Inaalam natin kung, number one, saan at paano pwedeng pagsamantalahan ang confidential funds. Number two, ano ang ahensya ng pamahalaan ba ang karapat-dapat pagkalooban nito? At ang ikatlo, ano ang dapat ilagay sa batas upang maiwasang maabuso ang paggamit nito upang protektahan ang kaba ng bayan mula sa mga abuso? Ganun na lamang ang pagkadismaya marahil ng karamihan sa mga natutuklasan natin dito sa House Blue Ribbon Committee. Nakita natin dito kung paano ginamit at ginastos ng Office of the Vice President at ng Department of Education ang pondong kompidensyal na ipinagkaloob sa kanila sa mga taong 2022 and 2023. Marahil, pwede nang masabing improper ang gamit sa confidential funds ng mga ahensyang ito. Upang mas mabigyan pa tayo ng linaw, nararapat na masagot ang katanungang ito. Anong nangyari sa pera ng taong bayan? Masasagot lamang ito ng 2 tao. Una, ang head of agency, which in the case of both the OVP and the DepEd is the vice president. At ikalawa, ang special disbursement officer, SDO, na sila Ms. Gina Acosta para sa OVP at Mr. Edward Fajarda para sa DepEd. Ngunit ni isa sa mga ito ay hindi nagpapakita sa atin. Pakita po yung slides.
Your Honor, the Information Technology Department is having difficulty in flashing. There you go, Your Honor.
Dito po makikita po natin yung 2 slides na nagpapakita po ng matrix kung paano po ginamit ang 2022 and 2023 OVP and DepEd confidential funds na na-release, in-encash at ni-liquidate ng Vice President at SDOs indicate other signatories to the DVs, checks, LRs, and ARs and their relationship to the VP. Ang tumitestigo lang sa ating investigasyon ay sina former USEC Gloria Mercado at USEC Annalyn Sevilla mula sa DepEd, ang dating SDO ng DepEd na si Edward Farda ay napag-alaman naming lumipat na sa OVP. Hindi maiiwasang magtaka ang iba na bakit OVP at DepEd lang ang nakasalang sa usapin ng confidential funds. We have to start somewhere. At dahil nasimulan na natin ito, nakita natin na ang mga kaduda-dudang justification sa gastos para sa safe houses worth 16 million for 11 days at 15 million para sa youth leadership program kung saan pondo naman pala ng Philippine Army ang ginamit. Our inquiry does not end with 15 or 16 million or 73 million. Sa totoo lang, 612.5 million ang kabuuang halaga ng confidential fund ang ibinigay sa OVP and DepEd sa loob ng 2 taon. Dito po makikita po natin ang graph showing disbursement of to OVP and DepEd totaling 612.5 million. Nasaan na ngayon ang 612.5 million? Sino ang gumastos nito at para saan ito ginastos? Dahil dinisalaw ng COA ang 73 million confidential funds ng OVP, ating siniyasat kung bakit ito nangyari, saan napunta, at paano ito ginamit. Ngunit kung susumahin ang lahat ng confidential funds ng OVP at DepEd, ito ay abot sa higit kalahating bilyong piso o 612.5 million. Base sa salaysay ng mga testigo at mga dokumentong nakalap, lumalabas na pawang hindi kapani-paniwala, haka-haka o gawa-gawa lamang ang mga proyekto at programang pinaglaanan at ginastusan ng confidential funds. Kumbaga, bogus, dahil hindi may paliwanag kung saan ito talaga man napunta. Sa mga nakaraang 3 pagdinig ay natuklasan natin ang mga sumusunod. Una, para po sa taong 2022, kasama sa 125 million confidential funds ng OVP na ginastos, sa loob lang ng 11 araw, ang 16 million nito ay ginastos para sa upa at maintenance ng 34 safe houses. Sa 16 million na ito, makikitang may isang safe house na ginastosan ng 1 million base sa mga acknowledgement receipt para lamang sa 4 araw. Lumalabas na 250,000 per day ang upa at maintenance nito. Marahil kahit mag-check-in ka pa sa pinakamahal na hotel dito sa bansa ay hindi aabot ng ganitong kalaki ang iyong bill. Para sa taong 2023, the OVP spent confidential funds amounting to 125 million for the first 3 quarters or a total of 375 million. The OVP spent for safe houses alone 16 million in the first quarter, 16 million in the second quarter, and 5 million in the third quarter. Next slide, please. Dito po makikita po natin emphasizing the amount spent for safe houses in relation to the months it supposedly covered. Talaga bang kinakailangan nila yung mga safe houses na to? Legitimate po ba yung paggastos nila dito? Bakit kaya hindi na sila gumastos para sa safe house sa buong taon ng 2023? Pangalawa, aside from the anomalous and unreasonable amounts paid for the safe houses, for the other expenses po na ginamitan ng confidential fund ay may similar pattern. hindi reasonable ang halaga at mas malala ay umabot ng 612.5 million ang gastos na suportado lamang ng acknowledgement receipts with only basic details which can be easily fake. Pangatlo, napag-alaman din natin na ang certifications mula sa infantry battalions ng Philippine Army ay ginamit upang palabasing may natanggap na mahigit 15 million ng confidential funds ang Army mula sa DepEd. Subalit, mariing pinabulaanan ito ng mga mismong pumirma sa mga certifications. Hindi rin alam ng ating mga sundalo na ang kanilang certifications ay gagamitin ng DepEd upang suportahan ang paggasta sa kanilang confidential funds. Sana ba talaga ginastos at napunta ang pera kung hindi naman pala ito ginastos para sa Philippine Army? In audit observation memorandum number 2024-015 dated February 1, 2024, first AOM, DACOA flagged the report. Payment of rewards to the informers in the amount of 7,509,000 in the first quarter of 2023 and 8,031,000 in the second quarter of 2023 because these expenditures were not supported with required documents. In sum, this amounts to 15,540,000 of public funds. Walang ebidensya kung saan ginastos at walang konkretong pagpapatunay na ito ay pinamigay bilang katimpala sa mga taong nakapagbigay ng mahalaga at makatotohanang impormasyon maprotektahan ang ating mga kabataang estudyante. Sa nakaraang pagdinig at nagmula kay Attorney Poa utos kay Yusek Mempin upang humingi ng katibayang maibibigay sa COA upang patotohanan ang paggasto sa confidential funds. Si Yusek Mempin naman, na dating commander ng Task Force Davao, ang humagilap ng certifications at ginamit na nga ito ni Attorney Poa sa pagsagot sa first AOM ng COA. Sinabi ni VP Duterte sa kanyang letter dated April 17, 2024, first AOM response na hinanda ni COS POA, the 15,540,000 was used for financial rewards given to informers for leads and or integral information received, which supposedly allowed the DepEd to formulate narrowly targeted programs, information campaigns, and intervention against recruitment, violent extremism, and other criminal activities in specifically identified communities. Pinapalabas sa sulat na kabilang sa mga programang kanilang finormulate ay ang Youth Leadership Summit, o YLS, and Information Education Campaign, IECS. Ngunit ito ay tahasang pinabulaanan ng mga AFP officers na pumirma sa mga certifications na hiningi ni Yusek Mempin. Pang-apat, lahat ng mga testigong humarap sa kamera ay nagsabing hindi nila alam nasaan ang pera at saan pumunta ang pera. As stated by Attorney Poa, when it comes to confidential funds, only two persons can answer the question, the VP herself and the Special Disbursing Officer, Mr. Edward D. Fajarda. Subalit, wala na si Mr. Fajarda sa DepEd. Siya ay nasa OVP na at kabilang sa mga tumatangging humarap sa ating pagdinig. Marahil, mas makabubuting kung sa halip na mag-presscon ay dumalo na lamang sa ating mga pagdinig upang harapin ang mga katanungang ito under oath kabilang ang kanyang mga tauhan. May paliwanag o wala, isa lang ang tiyak na sagot. Malamang hindi napunta ang confidential fund sa mga estudyante pati sa kanilang seguridad. The numbers drawn came from the very documents submitted by the Vice President. To close, I emphasize that the discoveries made by the committee is just the tip of the iceberg. Marami pa po tayong kailangan malaman at mahalagang dapat malaman kung saan napunta. Malinaw na madaling abusuhin ang confidential fund kung masyadong maluwag ang mga panuntunan sa paggamit nito. COA has been basically reduced to the ministerial task of checking whether the documents required to be submitted with respect to the confidential expenses are complete without even checking the veracity of the information contained in these documents compared to the audit of regular funds where transactions need further substantiation. This must be addressed to prevent not only leakage of government resources, but to close an avenue for graft and corruption. The mission of the committee is to craft a bill considering this relevance, these revelations, to regulate and ensure the proper use of confidential funds. Maraming salamat po. I now call on the COMSEC to provide the committee an update on the invitations, requests, correspondences, submissions, and compliances.
Thank you, Your Honor. Before that, I would like to recognize the presence of our member, Honorable Loreto S. Amante of the 3rd District of Laguna, and Honorable Arnan C. Panaligan, 1st District of Oriental Mindoro. Your Honor, for today's attendees, we have invited Colonel Raymond Dante Pila Chica of the VPPSG. However, he sent his regrets, stating that he cannot attend due to prior equally important commitment. Mr. Morales is also the same, Your Honor. He cannot attend today. The Land Bank of the Philippines was invited. They have sent a list of their delegates. AVP Nanita Camposano, DOTC branch. DM Joyce L. Eclavea, DepEd branch. Attorney Rafael Christopher L. Yap, special legal concerns. However, they are still not physically present in this hearing, Your Honor. We are also in receipt of the position papers of the Office of the Vice President from the individuals who were subject of Sapina ad to Sestecum, and from the invitees coming from the satellite offices, Your Honor. They are not present in today's hearing, Your Honor. The Department of Budget Management and Management were also invited. However, they have a hearing in the Senate today and expressed their regrets in today's hearing, Your Honor. For the Sapina ad to Sestecum, Your Honor, it was service was refused. It was served on November 2. However, it was
Duces tecum or ad testificandum.
Pardon, Your Honor. Sabina ad testificandum. The Legislative Service Bureau of the Congress tried to physically serve it on November 2 to the DepEd. However, service was refused by the agency security, stating that they are no longer connected, particularly the spouses Edward D. Fajarda and Attorney Sunshine Chari A. Fajarda. When it was served to the Office of the Vice President in their office in Mandaluyong, the security of the building himself said that he will not accept it. It was again served yesterday, November 4, but the legal of the OVP refused to actually receive the subpoena ad duces tecum, Your Honor. But it was sent to their email last night. Please do note that the hearing was of October 28 was postponed due to the Typhoon Christine, as earlier stated by Your Honor. Thank you, Your Honor.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, the Chair would like to recognize the Senior Vice Chair, Bienvenido Abante.
Just would like to find out who is the one that did not accept the letter and what is his position.
COMSEC, please. Please answer the query of Congressman Abante.
Your Honor,
This is based on the report of the Legislative Service Bureau from the Legal Department of the Vice President. They were in coordination with her, Attorney Emily Torrentira. She was the one who refused to accept the subpoena, Your Honor.
Mr. Chair, is there any reason why she refused to accept the invitation? Did she give any reason, Mr. Chair?
What is the reason?
Your Honor, the Office of the Vice President submitted a position paper dated today, signed by the individual subject of the subpoena ad duces tecum. Part of their excuses was that to follow the procedure, the 3-day subpoena, service of subpoena procedure under the rules. However, they stated here that there was no subpoena received. But they refused to receive the same, Your Honor. Second, justification, Your Honors, the subject matter of the deliberation is not in aid of legislation and violative of the rights of the resource persons. They also raised jurisdictional issue and their right to decline invitations. And lastly, sub judice, because of pending cases in the pending case in the Supreme Court, Your Honor. The position paper, respectfully submitted November 5, 2024, were signed by the following individuals: Attorney Zuleika T. Lopez, Attorney Emmanuel Lemuel G. Ortonio, Attorney Rosaline L. Sanchez, Julieta L. Villa del Rey, Gina F. Acosta, Attorney Sunshine Chari A. Fajarda, and Mr. Edward D. Fajarda, Your Honors. There is another second position paper. However, this pertains to the satellite offices, the lead managers of the satellite offices, and not subject of the subpoena, Your Honors.
Mr. Chair, did these people who have invited wrote to us a personal letter why they cannot attend, or it was just more of a the person that actually said that they cannot accept the invitation?
Your Honor, it was not signed by the person who refused to actually receive yesterday. It was signed by the subject of the subpoena ad duces tecum, Your Honor. The subject of the subpoena.
Are all of these invited, Mr. Chair, still active in the Vice President's office, or they were actually working with the Vice President in a DepEd? Are they now working with the Vice President in her office as Vice President, Mr. Chair?
Pardon, Your Honor, I would like to correct my statement. It is subpoena ad tuces, testificandum, Your Honor. For the position paper, Your Honor, the committee and the secretariat has information that Attorney Sunshine Chari A. Fajarda was formerly an ASEC of the Department of Education. In the previous hearing, the position papers she submitted to the committee did not use the header of the Office of the Vice President. However, from the start of our hearings, Your Honor, Mr. Edward D. Fajarda, formerly the SDO of the Department of Education, submitted his position papers under the header of the Office of the Vice President. It was only today, in view of this position paper submitted today, that the Secretariat was made aware that Attorney Sunshine Chari A. Fajarda is now with the Office of the Vice President, considering that she signed her name here under the header of the OVP.
As to the question of Congressman Abante, with respect to the status of this subject, siguro we can ask the former undersecretary or the spokesman of the Vice President, Attorney Poa, if are you still connected with the... Well, I understand that you are no longer connected with DepEd, but how about in the Office of the Vice President? Are you still connected?
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Yes.
I would like to inform the Honorable Committee that I am no longer connected po with the Office of the Vice President. Hindi na po ako, yung consultancy contract ko po was already pre-terminated, Your Honor.
Not even as a spokesman?
Wala na rin po ako as spokesperson.
Okay, but are you aware of the status of the people who are subject of the subpoena?
Opo.
Are they still connected?
Honestly, Your Honor, when I was still there, yes, they were connected with the OVP. Although, as of today, hindi ko na po talaga masabi factually if they are still connected or not. I would assume because of the position paper with the letterhead that they're still connected. But I cannot confirm that because nagpaalam po ako, ano pa po eh, nagpaalam po ako na umalis prior pa po to the previous hearing that we had.
Mr. Chair, I assume
yes, Congressman Bante.
That Attorney Poa knows all of these people personally, di ba?
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, Your Honor.
So therefore, siguro at present, alam mo pa rin kung sino yung connected kay Vice President.
Yes, Your Honor.
Who are those people still connected with the Vice President?
Your Honor, as far as I know, those people are still connected with the Vice President. Although as of today, I really do not have personal knowledge. But as far as I know, they are still connected with the OVP.
Mr. Chair, how about Ms. Lopez? Is she still connected?
As far as I know, Your Honor.
Mr. Gonzaga.
Gonzaga?
Yeah, Emmanuel Gonzaga Ortonio.
Yes, Your Honor, as far as I know.
How about Rosaline Ladores Sanchez?
As far as I know, Your Honor.
Gina Acosta.
I don't have any interaction po with her, but when I was there, yes, I know that she was connected with those.
About Julieta Villa del Rey?
As far as I know, Your Honor.
Edward Fajarda?
Yes, as far as I know.
And Sunshine Chari Fajarda?
As far as I know as well, Your Honor.
Mr. Chair, I would assume that if all of these are connected with the Vice President, it is the Vice President herself that asked them not to attend this hearing.
So may I know if all these subject persons that were mentioned by the Honorable Abante are still, do you have any travel update?
Your Honor,
are they still? Yes, Congressman.
Mr. Chair, may I also? Mr. Chair.
Congressman Sia.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Chair. In line with the question of Chairman Abante, well, I'd like also to ask Attorney Pao, because she mentioned certain number of names, and you confirmed that they are still connected with the Office of the Vice President. Would you also know if an individual by the name of Kelvin Tuntinido and Maria Edelyn Rabago are still also connected with the Office of the Vice President?
Attorney Poe,
please respond.
Your Honor, I am not familiar with them because when I was spokesperson, I only dealt with the upper management. Although, yung Mr. Kelvin, I think I recall his name.
Yeah.
Although I cannot, in all honesty, say if he's still connected.
But when the time that you were connected with the Vice President, have you met these people?
Briefly,
would you say that, yeah?
Briefly, Your Honor, because of the budget hearings at that time.
Are they career officers of OVP?
I honestly wouldn't know, Your Honor.
Okay,
kasi
you.
I was only a consultant, Your Honor, so I beg your indulgence on that.
Okay, thank you, Attorney. Thank you,
Mr. Chairman. Just
Congressman Paduano.
Just to clarify things, because we're discussing some other names mentioned by members or colleagues, no, and members of this committee. While we have received already the official position from the Office of the Vice President, and was signed by 7 persons, subject of Isuprena at testificandum.
Yes.
So, Mr. Chairman, ganito na lang po because reading on the documents, no, that was as reply and an excuse from the Office of the Vice President signed by the 7 persons cited, issued by Isuprena at testificandum, certain Attorney Lopez, at Lemuel Ortonio, Attorney Sanchez, Julieta Villaderley, Gina Acosta, and the spouses, Sunshine and Edward Farda. Now, Mr. Chairman, question of being absent in the day's hearing was already discuss unanswered by this honorable committee, and otherwise, some of the members will discuss it once again with regards to question of subjudice, question of jurisdictional issue, and the right to decline the invitation. But one thing is important, Mr. Chairman, that they invoke the question of the 3D rule, which is our internal rules. So, Mr. Chairman, now to be safe, for this committee to be safe, may I respectfully move na lang, Mr. Chairman, to once again issue suspena ad testificandum to all those mentioned name. No? To all those mentioned name and what's issued previously a suspena ad testificandum to be present in the next hearing, Mr. Chairman. So move, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Deputy Speaker Suarez.
Second.
Well, actually,
Mr. Chairman, yes, before, with the indulgence of the members and the good chairman, Mr. Chairman, to expedite discussion with regards to the question matters at hand, may I just respectfully submit, Mr. Chairman, my official position with regards to the position or reply by the Office of the Vice President, just to expedite discussion, Mr. Chairman. Just for the record, Mr. Chairman, I will just submit my position with regards to sub judice, with regards to question of the trade rule, and the four reasons why those seven OBP officials are not present at this hearing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chair. Okay.
Yes, Congressman Abante.
According to the committee secretary, these people have been invited four times, but they failed to attend. As I am, I'm so glad for the kindness of Congressman Paduano in inviting them again for the fifth time. Now, Mr. Chair, if they will not come for the fifth time, then I might make a motion to hold them in contempt. Because this is the fourth time. This is unfair to these people here who have attended every time that they are called upon. And then we're just going to do nothing about these people here who have been invited four times? It's unfair for us too that we are here in this hearing and these people are kept on insulting us, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chairman.
Congressman Paduano.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With the manifestation made by the Honorable Vice Chair Abante with regards to the issuance of subpoena at the testificandum, let's cross the bridge. I think, Mr. Chairman, let's cross the bridge when we have the next hearing. No, tingnan po natin. But of course, we will just comply with our internal rules with regards to the trade rule. But question of due process with regards to invitation, Mr. Chairman, that is very clear. That we have invited them for the four invitations. So I really join the sentiment of Vice Chair Abante, but as of now, we cannot discuss about it since we have to comply with our internal rule. It is the trade rules, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Yes, before I make my ruling, I would just like to make a short manifestation. I totally in agreement with the manifestation of Congressman Abante, and in fact, the fact that all the other resource persons are present in today's hearing, bakit naman po sila naka-attend? Yung iba eh hindi maka-attend. But of course, for para po mawala na lang po yung mga agam-agam, and also to just like what Congressman Paduano said, to accommodate and in view of our 3-day rule, we will just reissue another subpoena with a stern warning that the next time that they fail to attend, we will be constrained to issue a much heavier penalty. Considering that there is a motion which was duly seconded by Congressman with Deputy Speaker Suarez, is there any objection? Hearing none, The motion is carried.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Deputy Speaker Suarez.
Yeah, I just want to make a quick manifestation. Unang-una ho ay pinapangalawahan ko po yung posisyon ni Congressman Abante patungkol po sa mga taong iniimbitahan ng committee ito upang magbigay ng impormasyon, pagpapaliwanag sa mga usapin na pinag-uusapan natin. Kung hindi po ako nagkakamali, Mr. Chairman, pang-apat na hearing na po natin ito. Tama po ba ako? This is our fourth hearing. I'm sure a great number of the Filipino people know what we're talking about. I'm sure the Office of the Vice President know what we're talking about. I'm sure the officials of the DepEd know what we're talking about. And being public servants, whether you're elected or you're appointed, it is part of your duty to make sure that you exercise transparency and accountability in the exercise of your duties and functions. Now, as an appointed official, having that oath that you have taken, pag meron pong mga patawag na ginagawa, ang Kongreso, maging ang Senado at ang mababang kapulungan, obligado pong umattend sila dahil napakahalaga po ng kanilang ibabahagi sa ating mga pinag-uusapan. So, alam ko naman po ay nakikinig yung mga iniimbitahan natin na ayaw sumipot. Pakiusap ko lang po sa kanila para naman matapos na po ito at makapagpatuloy na po tayo sa ilang bahagi. Ang habo lang naman po natin dito ay katotohanan, pagpapaliwanag lang kung paano ba ginastos yung pera. Hindi naman siguro masyadong mahirap ipaliwanag kung tama naman po ang paggastos ng pera. So, sinususugan ko po yung posisyon ni Congressman Paduano na pagbigyan natin muli ng, sige, isa pa. Isa pang pakiusap. Tulad na lang ng ginawa natin ng budget hearing, pinagbigyan na naman natin ng isa pang pagkakataon para humarap sa plenary. Kasi lang sana naman po, ito na ang huling pagkakataon na ibibigay natin. Dahil mahalaga po ang oras natin, mahalaga po yung oras ng mga taong pumupunta dito. Ako po ay nakikiisa sa pasasalamat sa inyong lahat. Dahil alam ko naman po ay inaabot po tayo minsan dito ng 8-10 oras sa pandinig. But you give time. You open up your schedule because you know the importance and the significance of these hearings. So again, Mr. Chair, I just wanted to manifest that I am very disappointed with the position of our invited guests. For again, for the fourth time, not attending our hearing. And I do hope that when we do issue the subpoena tomorrow, we can take our proper action. Now my question, Mr. Chair, is what other legal remedy does the committee possess insofar as to secure, number one, if our resource persons are still in the Philippines? Number two, to avoid flight. Number three, to ensure that their presence will be here in the following hearing.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Congressman Abante.
In relation to the question of my good friend, Congressman J.J. Suarez, nakalagay po dito sa pinadala sa atin na information that only Zuleika Lopez departed on November 4. Emmanuel Gonzaga Ortoño arrived November 20. Rosalyn Ladore Sanchez arrived May 21. Juliet Villadelrey arrived October 5. Edward Fajarda and Sunshine Chari Fajarda arrived June 25. Now, wala pa naman po nang naka-report na umalis sila uli. Sa palagay ko po, hindi lang talaga, I just would like to manifest, Mr. Chair, na napakabait po ng Committee on Good Government for giving them the chance for the fifth time to attend. sana naman po ay hindi na kami ipahiya dito sapagkat para bang nararamdaman ko na umiiwas sila na tanungin kung paano ginamit ang pondo ng ating pamahalaan na dapat nilang linawin sa komiteng ito sapagkat tayo po ang binigyan ng mandato ng konstitusyon upang ating busisiin ang pondo na ginagamit ng bawat ahensya ng gobyerno, Mr. Chair. Kaya sa akin po, nakaka-disappoint sapagkat dapat ipaliwanag hindi lamang sa ating komite, dapat ipaliwanag sa taong bayan kung paano ba ginamit ang pondo ng taong bayan, Mr. Chair.